St. Luke's, where spirits come alive. It's a joy to welcome all of you to worship this morning, and a warm welcome to our visitors and those who are joining us from home on streaming. Please fill out an attendance slip, and those who are on streaming, please give us a shout out on Facebook. For worship, you need an individual serving of communion, and those at home can get a piece of bread and some juice or wine for the sacrament later in the service. If you're a visitor, please leave a cell phone or email or Facebook message me with some contact information. I'd love to take you to coffee or a slushy and get to know you better. The flocking has begun, and in fact, Rita Humphrey has a picture of it. She flocked her granddaughter, and she's famous in her neighborhood now. The youth are doing this as a fundraiser, so if you would love to give somebody some flamingo love, please talk with Lynn Singletary and help our youth raise money for the youth gathering next summer. There are forms in the gathering area, and you can fill those out and put them in the basket. The extra flowers this morning are from the memorial service of Bob Patchen last Thursday, and we give thanks for this saint of the church whose life we celebrated. I now invite Betty Seaborn forward. She's the chair of our global mission team, and she has an announcement, and she's going to come up and use this microphone. Thank you, Betty.
Good morning, everybody. I'm excited and happy to be here this morning to tell you about the mission trip that we have planned. Initially, we had hoped to go to Ethiopia, where the Lutheran Church is just growing by leaps and bounds. But of course, that pathway has been thwarted completely by the civil war there. So we've now turned our attention to the Texas-Mexico border, where, of course, everybody is aware there's a great need for help with all the migrants. Although this is a highly political issue these days, we all need to remember that Jesus' family were immigrants themselves. They escaped persecution and went to Egypt. And I think everybody in this congregation is either an immigrant or the descendant of an immigrant. Whether you came here by boat 400 years ago or by plane 2 weeks ago, we all came from somewhere. And sometimes we were fleeing from something, or sometimes we were more going towards greater hope. But we're all here, and we share something in common with all those migrants. So our trip is in conjunction with the Lutheran model of mission, which is accompaniment, where we recognize that we're all God's children, and we're not just going to help them, but we're going to learn from one another. So we are partnering with a sister congregation in El Paso. It's Iglesia Luterana Cristo Rey, Christ the King Lutheran Church, where they have been doing a program for several years. And we will be going the first week of June, June 4th to 11th. Anyone aged 15 or older who's interested can go. Junior high kids can go if they're accompanied by a parent. Knowledge of Spanish is nice, but not optional, but not necessary at all. While we are there, we will participate in bilingual worship. We will assist the members of Cristo Rey in their programs that they're conducting with the migrants, and we'll listen to the stories of the migrants. There's also an optional trip overnight to Juarez, which participants can either go, or if they choose not to, that's fine too. We're planning to have a meeting to answer your questions on Sunday after next, the 24th, in the adult ed room. So we hope many of you will come and will join us for the trip. Thank you.
Thank you, Betty. It's exciting to have our global mission team moving forward with plans, and of course, plans to travel to Ethiopia with our connection with Pastor Seleshi was also disrupted, not only from the war, but also from COVID and the limitations of global travel. Let us turn our hearts and our minds toward worship as we confess our sins. Please rise in body or spirit. In the name of God, the Creator, the Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God desires a deep and intimate relationship with us, rooted in grace and truth. We come to our confession with honesty of heart, trusting in God's never-failing love. Holy God, we open our hearts to you this day. We confess the depth of our sin and struggles, the fear that paralyzes us, the prejudice that blinds us, the ignorance that hobbles us, the doubt that plagues us, the self-centeredness that stifles us. Forgive us and free us by your power. Restore and help us, we pray, to see ourselves and others with new and gracious hearts, to move toward those places where love is needed, and to trust the courage of your Spirit within us. Amen. Friends, hear the good news of the gospel. The mercy of God is from everlasting to everlasting. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven and you are made new. Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify God who is in heaven. Amen. Our opening hymn is O God, our help in ages past. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Let us pray together, Almighty and ever-loving God. Increase in us your gift of faith that, forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to what lies ahead, we may follow the way of your commandments and receive the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated. In our Luke's Learners Sunday School, we are still learning about Abraham and Sarah, who are about to have a baby named Isaac. And when God made the promise to Abraham and Sarah, God told them that they would have descendants as numerous as, anybody know? The stars. And God also said that they would be a blessing not just for themselves and not just for the people of Israel, but for the whole world, right? That they would be a blessing to all nations. That is a really big, big plan, isn't it? As many as the stars, and a blessing to all nations. And how did it start? With quintuplets? You'd think you would need a big plan, so maybe God would start with maybe 5 kids at once? No. Quadruplets? No. Triplets? No. Twins? Did God at least start with twins? No. How many babies did God start this enormous, huge plan with? One. One. And we talked about his name last week, which is what? Isaac. God started with one baby and 2 really young, very fit, able-bodied parents. No. God started with one baby and very old parents who were 190 years old. Now, why do you suppose God did that? Do you think they could pretend that they could do it on their own? No pretending, right? They could not pretend that they could do descendants as numerous as the stars and become a blessing to all nations all by themselves. When you start with a 100-year-old dad, a 90-year-old mom, and one baby named Laughter, or Isaac. That's a very tiny beginning for such a big, big plan, isn't it? Well, God starts in small ways for really big blessings. And God uses our family, however big or small it is, for really big blessings. And God uses our church family, whatever size it is, for really big blessings. So today I want us to learn a blessing that we can give each other as a reminder that we experience God's blessings with each other and in our families and in our church family. It's very simple, and parents can do this to their kids, spouses can do this to each other, church members can do this to other church members, you can do this to your friends or your cousins or your neighbors or whoever. So, you've just put, we'll do it on ourselves first because we also have to bless and love ourselves as a sign of God's love. So we'll start with ourselves. Put your finger on your forehead, and we're going to make the sign of the cross. And as we make the sign of the cross, we're going to say, Jesus loves you. Say it. I don't hear you. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you, and so do I. Okay, now I want you to do that to somebody near you. You're going to put the sign of the cross on their head as a blessing. Jesus loves you, and so do I. And if you're not near enough to do that to somebody, then you can do it after church. Everybody can remember that, right? Let's say it again. Jesus loves you, and so do I. Okay, I don't have a mask on, so I'm not going to get that close to Michelle, so I'm going to do it in the air. Jesus loves you, and so do I. So if you can get close enough, be sure they have a mask on. Bill is in the front by himself. Debbie did Joe, thank you. Bill, Jesus loves you, and so do I. And what does that sign of the cross on the forehead remind us of? Baptism. That's right. I just realized I stepped out of the streaming camera. Sorry about that. Sorry about those at home. I'm back here. And Betty Kennedy, she's over here. Jesus loves you, and so do I. Okay. I know that we're supposed to physically distance, so if you do that, you can put your mask on after church and give each other a blessing. So if we do that on Sundays, at dinner time, at evening prayers, when somebody is hurting, we remember that God uses all of us to be a blessing and that we are the fulfillment of God's promise. We are part of the descendants who are as numerous as the stars, and we are part of the blessing to all nations, and that we are part of God's fulfillment of the promise to Abraham and Sarah. Okay, let's have our children go with Lynn to their Luke's Learners classrooms, and they're going to learn more about Abraham, Sarah, and Isaac. And we continue with our reading.
A reading from Hebrews. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Word of God, word of life.
Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Most pastors I know are not real excited when this text comes up in the lectionary. But I was, honestly, excited to read this text when I heard the news about the Pandora Papers coming out, reporting about the uber wealthy using legal ways to hide their money in shell companies and not so offshore investments in places like South Dakota and Nevada and Florida. We get to judge them with Jesus. What great timing, huh? Wow, I love it. Oxfam International, a British consortium of charities, said this about the Pandora revelations. "Whenever a politician or a business leader claims there is no money to pay for climate damage and innovation, for more and better jobs, for a fair post-COVID recovery, for more overseas aid, they know where to look." It feels so good to be righteous, doesn't it? And to point an accusing finger at those who are not doing the right thing, even if it is legal, and paying their fair share of taxes or alimony or whatever it is. But you know that our self-satisfied, self-righteous judginess is not going to last, right? I do not think that Jesus specifies that his words apply to the rich man and not to the rest of us. We may not have offshore accounts, I sure don't, but that does not mean that Jesus' harsh words toward the wealthy slide right by us and we get off scot-free. The World Bank, which works to reduce poverty and build shared prosperity in developing countries, reports that nearly half of the world's population lives on less than $5.50 a day. That's $2,000 a year. Global extreme poverty rose in 2020 for the first time in over 20 years as the disruption of the COVID-19 pandemic compounded the forces of conflict and climate change, which were already slowing the progress of poverty reduction. About 120 million additional people are living in poverty as a result of the pandemic, with a total expected to rise about 150 million by the end of 2021. So while we may not be hiding money in shell companies or offshore tax shelters like American tech tycoons or world leaders or global celebrities, we still stand squarely next to the rich man among the wealthiest in the world. If we have more than $2,000 to live on this year, we are doing better than half of the world's population. And most of us, including me, are in a much higher income category globally. Shoot. That's why I didn't want to preach on this passage. That's why pastors don't want to preach on this passage. The hardest thing about this passage is that the man is doing everything right. He treats people with honor. He keeps the commandments. He does not lie, cheat, or steal, or defraud, and he even honors his parents. He would not be listed in the Pandora Papers. And maybe that's why he wants to talk with Jesus. Like us, he wants to prove that he is righteous. But that is not enough in Jesus' kingdom calculation. And the next verse is the most important verse in this passage, but we usually miss it because it doesn't seem to fit, and it goes by so quickly we hardly notice it. Did you know that we rarely receive an explanation for why Jesus says what he says and does what he does? We only get a reporting in the Gospels of what he says and does. But here, Mark tells us why. Jesus looked at the rich man and loved him. Jesus does not judge the rich man. Jesus is not angry with him. He's not even waving the banner of justice for the poor. Jesus simply and purely loves this wealthy man with all of his heart. And in this love, Jesus wants to free him to experience the abundant life that he came to offer, an abundance that has nothing to do with riches. Jesus loves him and wants him to experience life in relationship with God that is full of acceptance and forgiveness and identity, rooted in a relationship with Jesus, a relationship of love that is freely given apart from anything that the man has earned or owns. Just pure love. Jesus, looking at him, loved him. Loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go and sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And then come, follow me. Jesus invites him to release his attachment to his possessions and to attach to Jesus instead. The rich man could not do it, at least not that day. Maybe he did it later, but that's the frustrating thing about the Bible. They don't have a volume two with the follow-up stories. You know, not tune in next season, or next season is coming in the winter of the second century. We don't get that. But at this moment, he was too enamored with his money and his possessions. His money was more important than his relationship with Jesus. His possessions were more valuable than experiencing the realm of God here and now. His stuff was more prized than the treasure of God's love for him, and more than sharing and lifting up the poor. So the rich man walked away sad and grieving, for he had many possessions. Perhaps even more startling is that Jesus let him walk away. It surprises me that Jesus didn't chase after him. He didn't say, "Wait, I didn't really mean it. You can experience the fullness of life that God desires from you, and you can still have your stuff be more important to you than me." Nope. He let him walk away and consider what really mattered to him. Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. It's a ridiculous image, isn't it, to get the point across. A little sewing needle, I don't know how big needles were in the first century, probably bigger than ours today, but even if they were this big, a sewing needle, a giant camel, it's absurd. Then who can be saved? It's impossible with anyone with attachment to possessions to experience the kingdom of God now or ever. Exactly right, says Jesus. On our own, it is impossible. Which is why it is so important that we don't miss those three little words in the middle. That Jesus' motivation with the rich man is love, not judgment. Because with God's love, all things are possible. The rich man can experience God's love. In fact, he already has in Jesus. And without God's love, we do not have a prayer. None of us. Oh, we dislike this part of the story so much. Oh, we hate not being able to earn a little bit of God's love. It has annoyed human beings so much over the centuries that scholars and people have made up stories to explain this passage. Have you heard any of them? Have you heard the made-up story that the eye of the needle must have been the name of a gate to get into the city of Jerusalem, where the archway was really low and it was hard for a camel to get through? But maybe if a camel were small and flexible and had really good knees, they could get down and maybe they could get through the archway. And if that were possible, then maybe I could be the rare, well-off person, really humble, with good knees, and it would be possible for me to get into the kingdom without God. You're not laughing. Do you hear how silly that is? Am I a humble enough camel with knobby knees? I can get under the archway in Jerusalem. It's silly, but yes. When I pulled up this passage, there were pictures of a camel next to an archway. That's how embedded this is. No, that is not what Jesus means. Tiny sewing needle, big camel. Is that possible? No. It's impossible for any of us to enter the kingdom of God without Jesus' love. Because it's too easy to attach to our stuff and our money with more fervor than we attach to God. And so Jesus invites us to let go, not out of judgment, but out of love. Because the fullness of life, the release of anxiety, the deepest experience of love that he desires for us is with him and in community with each other, with those who love him, and with them serving those who are suffering. So ultimately, the sadness of the rich man is not that he had many possessions to lose, but that he was in the presence of God, in Jesus, and he was offered love and the fullness and the meaning of life itself. And he walked away. He had the greatest possession he could ever have in Jesus Christ, and he left it behind. That is sad. That is worth grieving over. And it makes me wonder, what if all the time and energy and creativity that went into all those legal but evasive investments reported in the Pandora Papers were instead invested out of love? The love that Jesus feels towards this rich man and toward all of us. I know it's a fantasy, but it's a good one. I spent a lot of time thinking about it this week because Jesus doesn't want anyone to miss out on his love. So just imagine Jesus loving every single one of those people listed in the Pandora Papers. Jesus does not want to miss loving them and doesn't want them to miss out on how much he and God love them. He loves them. But we can start with ourselves. What if we all handled our resources from the starting point of Jesus' love for us and the desire for fullness of life with him? What if money were simply and only an instrument of love? We love God, and we give to Jesus' mission here, and we help the poor and hungry. It's all about love. We love our family, and we provide for them without needing to have the best or the most, and we live with a theology of enough, which is a theology of love. Give us this day our daily bread. We provide out of love. We love our community and our country, and we pay our taxes with love and gratitude for roads and for national parks and for public safety and for the blessings of the shared life. I dare you to kiss that tax check and put it in the mail and say, I love my country, I'm grateful for shared life and the blessings that we have because we live and work together. We love Jesus more than our stuff, and we hold our possessions lightly. Okay, if you've seen my closet, you know where I need to start this journey. I have too many clothes. That's why we don't like preaching on this, because we're always convicting ourselves first. At the end of our life, it will not be about our possessions. Because if we get to live a long life, and I pray that we all do, we will have detached from them anyway. We will have downsized. Some of you already have. And we will have given most of our possessions away. And our life will be all about our faith, our relationships, and about what?
Love.
Thank you. It will all be about love. I saw the kingdom of God and the fullness of life last week. It was 2 days before Bob Patchen passed away. And I saw him right after this happened. His possessions were reduced to very few. He was 90 years old and had been put on hospice because his kidneys were failing. He had rallied that Monday afternoon and he told his daughter Heidi that he wanted pepperoni pizza and a beer. Several of the family members gathered in his room and they ate pepperoni pizza and Bob drank a Shiner Bock from a plastic cup. And Heidi made a video of them making a toast, and everyone raised their glasses and clinked their beer cups with Bob. Then he took a sip of beer, and he went, "That is the soundtrack of an abundant life in the kingdom of God." Bob was about to die, but he knew and he trusted in Jesus' love. And he had no fear, no fear of death, no worry about stuff, just the fullness of life, celebrating the moment with his family, surrounded by their love and wrapped in God's love. And this is the abundant life that Jesus calls us to. Rich or poor, Jesus does not want anyone to miss out on his love and the kingdom community here that we have that shares his love and his mission. And so we can release our attachments to stuff and we can cling to Christ, trusting that in his love, nothing is impossible with God. Amen. Okay, I need a louder amen than that. Amen. Okay, thank you. You may be seated for the prayers. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. Loving God, you ask us to love you above all else. Help us to put our relationship with you above our riches and our possessions, and to use our blessings as instruments of love. Help us part with those things that are no longer beneficial to us and open our hearts to experience the fullness of the kingdom now. Curb our judgment of others and keep our hearts and minds close to our Lord Jesus Christ. God, in your mercy. Nurturing God, you bring forth crops from the soil and bounty from the trees. Increase the produce of the land and bless all who toil in fields and orchards. Provide for good working conditions and keep all who labor safe from harm. God, in your mercy. Empowering God, you offer compassion for those who are lonely and healing for those who are sick in body, mind, or spirit. We lift up those close to us, especially Barbara, Shirley, Bob and Martha, Billy and Aileen, Billy Jr., Rita, Ed, Annie, Bee, Bill, Linda, Joe, Nathan, Earl, Barbara, Steve, Shirley, Diane, Pastor Janet, Nancy, Eileen, the Miller-Seuss family, Lorraine, and those we name in our hearts or aloud now. Give strength to those who work in healthcare, emergency response, and the military, especially Tony, David, and Brian. God, in your mercy. Sheltering God, in Jesus you traveled among us without a place to lay your head. Provide safe places to sleep and rest for those who have no place to live. Sustain ministries that offer food, clothing, shelter, and assistance, especially the network of community ministries as they expand outreach in a new location. God, in your mercy. Eternal God, we thank you for the lives of those who have died, especially Bob Patchen, Betty Jane Harris, and Catalina Rivera. Make us confident in your promise of salvation and give us hope in the resurrection to life eternal. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now may the peace of the risen Christ and his love be with you always. Let us rise and wave the sign of peace to those in the balcony and to those who are joining us on streaming. And then you can greet those worshiping near you with a wave of peace. And you can greet your families with peace. Remain standing as you unwrap your individual serving of Holy Communion from the plastic bag. We continue with the offering prayer led by Michelle, found on the bottom of page 5 of your bulletin.
Let us pray together. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your love. And prepare us now to feast on the bread of life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and we join their unending hymn. God, you alone are holy, you alone are God. The universe declares your praise, beyond the stars, beneath the sea, within each cell, with every breath. We praise you, O God. Generations bless your faithfulness, through the water, by night and day, across the wilderness, out of exile, into the future. We bless you, O God. We give you thanks for your dear Son, at the heart of human life, nearer to those who suffer, beside the sinner, among the poor, with us now. We thank you, O God. You may lift up your elements at the words of institution. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering his love for us on the way, at the table, and to the end, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We pray for the gift of your Spirit in our gathering within this meal among your people throughout the world. Blessing, praise, and thanks to God through Christ Jesus, by your Spirit in your church without end. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. Take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. Rise in body or spirit for the blessing. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray, gracious God. In this meal, you have drawn us to your heart and nourished us at your table with food and drink, the body and blood of Christ. Now send us forth to be your people in the world, and to proclaim your truth this day and evermore. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
I invite you to be seated for our service of farewell and Godspeed for Reggie Sigler and Shirley Wilson Sigler. We're so sad that we're happy for them, but sad for us. Come on up and join me in the center, please. I'm gonna have you on this side, and I'm gonna be on this side. You come a little bit back toward the center. There we go. The scriptures are filled with people who have been called to new places. We've already talked about Abraham and Sarah. Of course, there's Mary and Joseph and Paul and Barnabas and Priscilla and Aquila. And filled with uncertainty about what lay ahead, these people could not have found their journeys easy, and yet they were also filled with excitement, as I know you are, trusting that God was calling them and guiding them to a new adventure. And now our beloved friends, Reggie and Shirley, are preparing to leave us, and they're not going to a new place, but rather back home, to Chicago, to Hyde Park on the south side, right near the seminary where I went to school, and they will be joining Augustana Lutheran Church right there across from the seminary. And as part of our body of Christ over the past years, you have given of yourselves and your faith, and we have so appreciated this, and we will miss you, your spirit, your faith, your presence, and your love terribly. And Reggie and Shirley have served as greeters, and Shirley, if I can say this, she's a self-identified church nerd, and she has served us so beautifully. She's been our council president. She was the council president when I came as the pastor 3.5 years ago. She is now the endowment board president, so we will need to find a new endowment board president. She has sung in the choir. She's been one of our delegates to the Synod Assembly. She is now serving on the Synod Candidacy Committee, so they will need to find a replacement for her there as well, and she has also served on our Synod Council. And so now we are going to ask God's blessing upon you, and we lift you in our hearts and in our prayer, and we give gratitude to God for your ministry and your faith and your time among us. Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, for you have created the wide and wonderful world in which we live. We praise you for your constant care, for those who have trusted you in ages past, who journeyed in faith to new lands of promise. And we trust that you now will hold Reggie and Shirley securely in your hands as they too follow your call back home to Chicago. May they take with them hearts filled with your love and grace, that those with whom they live and serve may see in them the face of Jesus Christ. Bless them that they may be a blessing. Guide them as they join Augustana Lutheran Church, where they may continue to grow in grace, in spirit, and in truth, and where they may serve using the many gifts you have given them. We ask your holy blessing upon them in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, as we wish them and pray for them your richest blessings. Let the church say, amen.
Amen.
And now will the whole congregation please rise for the benediction, and you stay right here for the benediction, and you can go in just a minute, but you have to stay here for the benediction. Okay. And now may the Lord Christ go with you wherever he may send you. May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again unto our door. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Our closing hymn was a request from Shirley. It's considered the Black National Anthem. Lift every voice and sing.
Thank you.
Rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, go forth into the world in peace to serve God with gladness. Have courage. Hold on to what is good. Return no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering and honor everyone as you love, serve, and welcome all. Thanks be to God, and we will.